the extra special. The biggest Canadian with the best diction on the planet, Tahmoh Penikett! Tahmoh, that doesn't look right. You sitting in that chair. Too small.
That's a little low, right?
Yeah, it's a little, that's not okay. Billy, why don't you bring that out? Yeah, there you go. We'll swap you out.
There we go.
There you go, that's an extra 3 inches.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you very much. Great to see you. I usually ask how big the, I go in and see the boys and ask how big the audience is before. And today I was like, you know what? This was so last minute and I'm not even supposed to be here. I'm just going to surprise myself, but what a nice surprise.
Check out these Friday people. I know you're thinking, Tahmoh, you're thinking, oh, convention Friday is going to be a real crap wad of people. Uh-uh. This is supernatural. This is a Friday crowd. These are Friday people. They're the best people. Take care of them, Friday people.
Now, I want to apologize right off the bat for not being Mark Shepard. I always wanted to be Mark Shepard, but I'm not. And this year I promised myself that I'm just going to love myself just the way I am. But yes, I'm here, and I'm going to give you as much as I can. I know I'm not Mark, but I'll do my best. Right? I was saying, come again?
Have you ever been on that
show? No.
Hi,
my
puns
lights are bright, aren't they?
My name's Kirby.
Kirby!
Hi, Kirby! Woo! I can't see you, but I can hear you!
I was actually really excited when I saw that you were replacing Mark, because I've been really wanting to meet you. I'm a huge, huge fan, so...
Oh, thank you very much, Kirby. Nice
sorry,
to meet
I'm
you.
Sorry, I'm fangirling over here just a little
not
bit.
Not at all. I can't see you again. I can hear you, though, so I can't...
I'm really short, too, girl. So it's kind of... Yeah. So, I loved Gadriel, and I loved absolutely how you portrayed him and everything. And I know that at the end, you know, I've watched some of your horror panels, so you didn't feel like, you know, him kind of going out with a bang was like a redemption for his character, because, you know, suicide isn't seen as a redemption, which I agree. But do you think that he kind of redeemed himself almost in the eyes of Sam and Dean, and even with Castiel towards the end, like when he decided that he realized what was really going on?
Yeah, I mean, I think he just answered it right there. I think he would have. Like, if we saw him again, I think that they would possibly be more accepting of him. With everything that they've seen, you know, in this long and storied journey of theirs, and to see and realize that he had made mistakes and he was trying to make amends for it at the end. Again, he probably didn't do it the right way, but it was obvious that he was tortured and he was not feeling good about the decisions and in a difficult sort of way, and he was trying to make amends. He was trying to make it better. I think he proved himself trustworthy at the end, though, to his fellow Angel Castillo, and I think Dean and Sam probably would have trusted him more for sure if he does come back.
Well, because I noticed there were a lot of parallels between Castiel's journey and how he transitioned from season 4, and then your character in season 9. How there was a lot of your learning curve was a little bit quicker. Than Cass was.
Yeah.
but it was like, you know, I felt like that the Winship would have, you know, forgiven it. Like, they would have cast made a lot of mistakes, too. And they were like, oh, it's okay, buddy. We still love you.
We still love you. You're an angel. It's okay. You're an angel.
but
you just try to figure it out.
Angels are all big.
I really liked the whole arc of the character, and I felt like he really got a story told, which was great.
Yeah, you know, what we accomplished, what the writers accomplished in 6 episodes was really impressive. And, you know, I had a fantastic time doing it. It was so cool. It was,
I love that you do your own stunts as well. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah. I mean, as much as they'll let me do
it. As long as you're not on fire or anything, you're
yeah, it's probably not a good idea. Yeah, but I do as much as I can. I insist on it, you know.
Yeah, and it was great. It was just awesome. I loved it, so...
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah! Woo! Kirby.
Hi.
Hi, Tommy. I'm Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. Sarah with an H?
Yeah.
Nice.
So your name is really, really unique. When you started acting, did they ever try to get you to change your name or any kind of way? Give you a different last name or something?
No, nobody did. I'm not sure if anybody suggested it. It's always been a conversation piece. You know, when I was younger, I'm very proud of my name and my heritage. Very, very proud of it. But, you know, like most kids, because my name was slaughtered by 98% of the teachers that I had, you know, growing up. And these were teachers. These were people who were supposed to teach us. And somehow, so many of them managed to, like, throw in an extra syllable. They'd be like, Timotei or Tuma. It was very odd. People always slaughtered my name. So when I was younger, I, you know, at times I was frustrated with it, or I'd get pissed off trying to, you know, repeatedly explain how to say my name properly. But, you know, as I grew older, I definitely just owned it and became more proud of it. I've always been proud of it, but in a different way, in an adult way. And I actually look forward to the fact that, you know, nobody would have my name, and I knew that for a fact. That's cool. That makes me stand out. Yeah, it's neat. It's always a conversation piece. You know, people, obviously, because I'm kind of pink and partially freckly, and people always like to make assumptions about my background, my ethnicity. I've had a lot of Finns. Finnish people always think I'm Finnish. Interesting, right? I think I play hockey. I mean, hey, I'm not Chantier. Irish people, everyone. You know, I can be anything, and I am though. I'm a mix, like most people. I've got Welsh blood. You know, my Native American blood. I've got British blood. I've got a little bit of everything. So I love my name. Thank you. Woo! Hi.
Hi. It's nice to meet you. And I was just wondering, you mentioned how...
Is that a little...
Yes,
little
this is Tiny Castiel.
Oh, that is adorable.
Say hi.
Hi.
Say hi. Or
are
you going to peek behind the microphone? But you were on the show for a relatively short time, especially in comparison to how long it's been running, and yet they managed to give you such a well-rounded and multifaceted character and just a really amazing background. And the way things changed and developed for you.
It's a challenge.
She's 4. I'm sorry.
That's a fantastic age. She's adorable.
Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
But what was it like for you playing a character that didn't have such a big role, but was still such an enormous part in the end, and the way that things changed for your character as Gadriel?
I mean, you know, the writers gave me a fair amount, but I came in quite blind. I wasn't really told what I was going to be doing. I didn't know that I was going to be playing sort of... What is she saying?
Flower.
Flower.
Giant flower on the carpet.
Let's get her some flowers. Oh, there's one right there. We'll try and rustle up some other ones. I'll give you those weeds, but I don't know. Whatever that is, I'm not sure.
That was a cradle over my car.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Yeah.
A little nice touch.
But yeah, I came in blind. I even on the first episode, I found out a lot about my arc, and I only knew that I'd be doing 3 episodes at that point. But... you know, they hadn't explained where I was going to be going, and so I came in with a lot of choices, and some of them I had to change immediately.
5 minutes before?
Especially when I found out that Jared had already played my character, which I didn't know. And that was a little surprising, you know, when the director, the kind director was, you know, 5 minutes before my first take, was like, do you want to see what Jared's done with... playing Gadriel, and I'm like, I mean, I tell this story every con, but it never gets old. I was like, come again? Do you want to see what Jared said? Because we're about to shoot. We've only got, about 4 minutes, 30 seconds now. Do you want to see that? And I'm like, so he's already played the guy that I'm going to be portraying. Yeah, that's probably a good idea. Why don't you show that to me? Because I was already nervous. Now I'm Yeah, there's a good chance I'm going to have a meltdown here. But let's check it out. Let's see what I can incorporate with my amazing acting technique in 4 minutes and 15 seconds or whatever it was.
Well,
but luckily, he was very specific in his physicality and stuff. And I was able to incorporate some of that very quickly into what I decided already. And then as the arc went on, you know, it was good. They gave me stuff to work with. But, you know, I think the job of an actor is... we always have to bring our own stuff to the table. You have to do your own backstory. You have to make your own choices. I just try to, and I try to go against the grain sometimes. You know, sometimes they write it, not really one note, but they try and force you to go in a different direction. It's always good to go against that sometimes.
Well, I think you did an amazing job. And it was really interesting to go from
you being
a character that was pretty genuinely despised to just the emotional reaction to your departure. Because I mean, you didn't forget about Kevin, buddy.
Just turn around.
Yeah. I hear that every time. There's always some people who come to the signing table and like, most of them are kind of joking, but some are very serious about it.
That was someone that you wanted to like, even when you did have some redeemable things, to in the end, like, I cried. And so, like, you did a really good job. So
thank you so much.
Congratulations
on that.
Yeah, woo! Woo! Yeah!
It's a fantastic version of a human monkey joke right now. It's rolling all over. Hi.
Hello, I'm Clarissa.
Hello. What is it?
Clarissa.
Clarissa, nice to meet you.
Hello, Clarissa. You made me nervous. I was all good, and then you did that, and now I'm nervous.
Okay, I'll look over here.
Still looks handsome.
So I've noticed that J2 tend to prank people who are shorter than them.
Holy.
Since you are not, please tell me you've done something horrible to them.
Unfortunately, no. Nothing horrible. Nothing horrible. If I go back, I'll take that into consideration. And there may just be some sort of horribleness going on, coming from me. I can't say that, you know, I have gotten them both extremely intoxicated before.
Yeah!
Some people might consider that horrible. I thought it was great. I hated it at the time. They were having a fantastic time. I can't speak for them the next morning, though. I'll
That's
work
awesome.
On that.
That's awesome.
Get them drunk and get them film it. Right?
Yeah.
Hi, my name's Shannon, and I was wondering, what was your favorite scene to film as Gadriel, and which one was the toughest?
Good questions. Favorite scene... I was like... you know, I love challenging scenes. Emotionally challenging scenes. The scene where Dean has me tied up. And he's beating me down. It wasn't very long, but that was a good scene. That was great. You know, Jensen established from the first day that we worked together, you know, his commitment and his passion for the craft still, which is really, like, he's truly a craftsman. He takes his job very seriously. He's not lazy. Excuse me. He's not dialing it in. He gives 110%, and he, bless you for that third.
He's in tight.
And, you know, he just gives 100%, and that's the best thing, because that's why we do this. It's the best thing in the world to act with somebody who's...
it's very serious.
Yeah, it's a give and take thing, man. That's why we do it. That's the games we played when we first started this. It's, you want somebody to reciprocate. It's a give and take. It's an accepted offer. It's a dance. It's the best. And I love when you're doing it. Thank you. Yeah, I love when you're doing an emotional scene with another actor. They're giving you something. And sometimes it isn't the other actor's job to say if one of them is being really emotional, the other to match that intensity. But be present. Be present. Be present. Listen. Be present. He's always done that. And And, you know, I really looked, when I read that scene on the page, I was looking forward to it. I was like, okay, this is going to be good. We're going to have fun. And, I don't think there was a scene that I didn't enjoy shooting with those guys. I had a blast the entire six episodes. And then what was the second part of the question?
What was, like, the toughest to film?
It was probably my final scene. That was challenging because it's weird. Sometimes you read it on the page and you picture it completely differently than you end up doing it. And I've been doing this for a while. I usually have a pretty good sense of how they're going to do it with a camera or whatever. But I wasn't clear with the way it was described on the page was very different from how we ended up doing it. Yeah, and I came in with specific choices, and again, which often happens in our job, I had to adjust those a little bit. And we did it on the day, and it ended up working out, but at first I was like, oh, shit. And the director, he's a great director, but he was kind of going, oh, shit, too. Because there was some confusion about the set and the way it was designed, and it was different from, it happens sometimes. Yeah. So we were kind of scrambling right before we shot it. We were trying to make it work, and we were very quickly playing with our options and trying to decide what was going to make it most believable. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Mackenzie, and my question is, what made you want to get started in acting?
I don't know when it actually happened, like the switch happened, but I've wanted to act ever since I was very, very young. My father was in, he had a theater company when he was in university and out of university. He did a number of productions. He's a playwright. It's one of his passions. So I grew up being around that somewhat, at least hearing my father talk about it. And my dad was also a career politician, so he was a very, very busy man, a workaholic. But one thing that he would often do with me when he wasn't there and coming back and we had some downtime together is take me to the movies. And I just love the cinema, man. My dad's he likes good films. He appreciates good writing and good acting, and I think he instilled that in me from a young age. But, you know, I appreciate any storytellers. You know, my grandmother, oftentimes, as most of us know, some of the best storytellers in your family or friends are people who are a little bit more mature in age, even the elderly, you know? It's an art form that takes a long time to get very good at, to really catch your audience, to engage in them, to make you, you know, empathize and sympathize with the characters and the story. And I always respected that with people who were older. I was really drawn to anyone who could tell an excellent story. I just found it to be the most fantastic skill and talent to be able to do that. And, I luckily came from a couple different families, both sides of my families, there were more than a couple excellent storytellers in them. That's all I got. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Caitlin.
Hi, Caitlin.
So my question is, how has Supernatural affected your life?
How has it affected my life?
Like your acting career.
Well, that's a very good question. I'll tell you, honestly, in a completely positive way, just hear the keys jingling and I just see the lights. Like someone's coming to attack me. Don't do it. Quick. I have weapons here, too. I can make a weapon out of this. It's been a completely positive experience for me. I got to work with this fantastic family of actors and crew, this show that's been going on for a very long time. And as you know, this is it's very rare in the business. There's not a lot of shows that have been on this long. And these guys, who knows, when's it going to stop?
Never, never.
It just keeps going and going, and people are happy. The fans, you know, the passion and the loyalty, it hasn't dissipated in any way. And this fan base is just, it's really incredible. You guys give yourselves a huge, you know, round of applause, pat on your back. You gotta love yourself because it's a real, I've been doing this for a long time, I've been in the genre game for a long time, and this fandom is like no other. And you guys are very respectful, and you support each other, and you push causes together, the energy and love you guys have is an amazing thing. You're creating positive change.
Woohoo!
And I'm happy to be a small part of that. And I'm honored that I was able to join this family. So yeah, it's been a very positive experience in my life.
Thank you.
Good question.
Hi, I'm Cody. I just
want to,
as an actor, from your point of view, would you feel Cadriel was manipulated?
Yeah, I mean, he definitely was in the beginning. You know, obviously Metatron manipulated him, and Metatron's very good at doing that. And, you know, he took advantage of a broken angel. He'd been in prison for thousands of years. Cadriel was not functioning. He'd just been tortured and in prison for so long, so he came out already damaged goods. And then on top of that, he's an angel that's, you know, in a human vessel. So he's lost some of his powers, he's down on Earth now, functioning amongst humans, everything's changed. It was too much at once. And, Metatron definitely manipulated that and took advantage of it. It took Cadriel a long time to realize that. It's very clear that he's a soldier from the beginning. He's someone who needs to be told what to do. And I think at one point he was, very, very respected and trusted by God in particular. And that's a huge honor. But he lost that. He lost that trust. And he lived for a very long time punishing himself and questioning everything he'd done and who he was. And he came out looking to redeem himself. And Metatron, very quickly and very smartly took advantage of that. Thank you.
Hi. My name is Kim.
Hi, Kim.
I love you, obviously, on Supernatural, but also as Hilo on Battlestar Galactica. Woo!
Nice. He is handsome. I love it.
Big time. So you play wonderful, good, moral, upstanding guys, but then you've also played some characters that are also bad. Mm-hmm. Which one do you prefer? The bad guy? Or the good guy?
You know what, because the beginning of my career for so long... Oh, sorry guys. I thought I was being too loud when I had it on. In the beginning of my career, because I played so many characters that were these outstanding moral characters, I was looking forward to playing some darker characters, and I've had that opportunity since, and it's been great, man. It's fun to do it all. I just want to be challenged. You know, I can't believe how much time has passed already. And that's just life, man. Time, you know, it's flying by. I want to challenge myself and play as many characters as I can, regardless of whether they're dark or bad or, you know, I'm playing bad characters too. You know, as an actor, we always have to... No one's really inherently bad. Not too many people are like, I'm bad, I'm a bad man, and that's all there is to it. I mean, it happens, but you have to find the good in your character, too. You have to find what he believes in or what he's trying to accomplish. I want to do it all, you know? In the last couple of years, I was able to do some comedy, too. And I'd never been given the opportunity to do that before. And that was a blast. I can't wait to do more of that. Yeah, right now I'm reading, I've got a big audition on Monday for, I'm not going to say what it is, but it's a new series, and it's as scary and dark as they make them. Yeah, I'm reading it right now, and it's, oh God, it's heavy. For TV, it's going to be heavy, but it's good, and I want to do it. So cross your fingers for me on Monday. Thank you.
Hi.
So my question is, what do you prefer, pancakes or waffles?
Depends on the mood. It depends on how much I drank the night before with Jared and Jensen. What about you?
Waffles.
You're a waffle kind of lady?
Yeah.
I like it. Do you use a lot of syrup or just a little bit?
A lot.
You use a lot of syrup, huh? Yeah, I don't have a really big sweet tooth, so I use a little bit of syrup, but I like some butter in there. A little bit of fruit, maybe? Whipped cream?
Yeah.
You're making me hungry. Thank you.
And now I'm hungry, too.
Me too. Let's get some, can we get some waffles? How many of us are there?
Hi, my name's Bonnie.
Hi, Bonnie.
Hi. And in standing in line, I just realized that you didn't know you were coming out here and weren't
I had no
here.
Idea.
So
no.
That probably means you don't have plans for Valentine's Day.
Yeah!
You need a Valentine. And available, sort of, after the convention.
What would we do? What would we do?
Oh, man!
Woo! See, that kind of leads into my next question.
It's getting hot in here!
So, after coming to these conventions, I actually learned about you through Supernatural, but coming to the conventions, people were asking questions about Dollhouse.
Yeah!
And like, what's Dollhouse? You know, I kept hearing about it, and I was like, all right, I'll check it out.
It's actually Wall House. What is the Wall House? That's an inside joke. We'll get that. Okay, sorry, go on.
So first of all, I wanted to say thank you to the Supernatural fans for introducing me to that show, because he doesn't have a shirt on in a lot. My favorite fight scene was the one where you and Echo were in hiding and you were training her and getting her prepared and she
oh,
wanted
that
to
hot
do
scene.
More.
Yes.
Yeah. So keep that in mind.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind for Sunday. But
yeah.
What was your favorite fight scene to film on Dollhouse?
I'm sorry. My mind is elsewhere. We were talking fighting? Yes, fighting.
If it dies, don't work.
I mean, the scene you mentioned was kind of... That was good.
That
was good for other reasons. I really enjoyed the scene where Echo and I fight in the Chinese restaurant.
Oh, yeah.
And then out into the street and onto the car and off the car. And
that was a rough fight.
That was a rough fight. Yeah. That was a lot of fun.
Good.
Sunday. Thank you very much.
Sunday!
Hello, my name's Kara.
Hi, Kara.
Hi. I actually wanted to talk about Dollhouse as well. Really enjoyed that show, both seasons, since the other one got put on Netflix. I wanted to know, if Joss Whedon approached you to be in a series, would you do it?
Joss Whedon? If he came to ask me, I'd be like, no, Joss. Didn't work out the first time. Maybe we should just... Let's just call it quits, man. Wasn't meant to be. Didn't work out. Let's just move on. You're the biggest director in the world now, doing billion-dollar films. I'm good.
You're good.
I got this web series happening. About 5 minutes long. Yeah. Oh, yes. Speaking of the web series, you're fantastic. I love these people. They help me promote us so much. These guys are great. I would love to work with Joss again. Of course, the man is incredible. I only get to see Joss every couple of years. We run into each other usually at Comic-Con and have some quick conversation. You know, everything that's happened to him was a long time coming. He was already huge, but now it's like the greater industry. The studios have really recognized his true talent. The man is brilliant. And as a fan, I can't wait to see, everything that he puts out. And as a friend, I'm so happy for his success. But yeah, I'd work with him again in a second. Thank you.
On that topic, actually, I wanted to know if Dollhouse had gotten another season, what would you have liked to explore with your character and what would you have liked to have seen happen?
That's a good question.
Thank you.
I think I was really excited at the prospect of playing other characters, like Paul getting imprinted. Something goes wrong, maybe Alpha gets in there, and I don't know, he makes me echo. You know, something. Playing a different character would have been cool. And I mean, that possibility was always there with that storyline, right? Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kendall.
Hi, Kendall.
I have sort of a unique spelling in my name, so I understand the teachers, how they butcher your name.
Yes.
So, I was wondering how you felt that Gadriel and Ezekiel had, like, unique names in the show.
I was comfortable with it. I was comfortable with it. But I recognized the unique names. I did indeed. I wish I could give you more, but I can't. Thank you. Thanks, Kendall.
Hi, I'm back again.
You're back again?
I'm back again. Kirby. It's Kirby.
Hi, Kirby.
Kirby.
So, I can actually see you this
Woo!
Time.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Okay, so I know the web series you're talking about is Rift World Chronicles, I'm assuming.
That is the one. Say it again.
Rift World Chronicles.
Say Woo! Rift World three times really fast.
Rift World, Rift World, Rift World.
Yeah! Woo! Kirby! She wins the prize.
So I heard you mention it in a panel a while back, and I was like, I've got to check this out, and I love it, and I want to know, is there more? Like, you were awesome as that character, and I haven't laughed that hard in a long time.
That's awesome. Thank you very much, Kirby. Yeah, we had a blast doing that. I got to do it with a dear friend of mine who I'd been in acting school with, you know, forever ago, and we'd never worked together. We didn't even, we were doing plays at the same time at the same acting school, but we never actually shared a scene. We were even on two of the same productions professionally, TV shows that were shot in Vancouver, but we would never share a scene. So when the opportunity came along, we really jumped at it, and we had a blast. It was, to date, one of the funnest things I've ever done.
On-screen chemistry was like really great. I just
awesome.
I loved
happy
it when
her.
She walked in, and of course you weren't wearing a shirt.
She's great, Woo! Isn't she? Aaron's
yes,
really
it was
good.
Kind of like a oh hi there, and suddenly the crazy guy wasn't so crazy anymore. it was really great.
She's like, he's crazy, but I'll take him down.
Yeah, it was, exactly. The second you weren't wearing a shirt, you weren't crazy anymore. It was pretty funny. But no, I just loved that character, and you did such a great job with it. And
thank you.
Especially the tea shop scene, that was hilarious.
That was a funny scene.
Yes.
I mean, you know, a lot of the credit has to go to Jonathan Williams, who wrote it and directed it.
Yeah.
Where we worked with Jonathan originally when we did The Portal, which was the short.
Yeah,
we
so did, yeah.
Yeah, we did that a couple years before. Jonathan had never directed. And, you know, I gave him a little bit of shit. I was a little bit of a handful because, you know, just... I come back sick from Thailand, and I was shooting the short, and I'm running around downtown Toronto in minus 30 with no shirt on, and they didn't know what they were doing, and they were new to it, so it was frustrating. And he was still new to it himself. He was obviously very bright, and he'd written this great script, but the first couple days were a little bumpy, and then I realized, okay, he's really getting it, and he's very smart, and he's very capable. And then Aaron and I both commented on it, and when he came back, when we did Riftworld, just his development as a writer was exceptional. His comedic timing, everything was so good. And then on top of that, as director, man, he was solid. He knew exactly what he wanted. He knew how to deal with us. He came so prepared. It was impressive. I can't wait to work with Jonathan again. So to answer your question, the main producers on the show, the ones who really brought it to us, they assure us that they're working very, very hard to bring it to life. We did get nominated for a Canadian Screen Actors Award, which is our academy. It's like, it's, you guys have never heard of it, of course, but it's a big deal in Canada, and it's a prestigious award. We get the best web series nomination, so that's a big deal. So it's still alive, and as a result of that, you know, the talks are happening about getting more money and bringing you more. I know in my heart we're going to bring you more. Whether it's a movie or a miniseries or a half hour or an hour, I'm not sure. It's going to happen.
It was incredible for the small amount of time you guys did it, because you said you watch it like an hour or like
yeah,
an hour and a half.
We have to give you more, though. Like, I'm not
so
satisfied.
Great.
I'm frustrated that I've been answering, you know, we've been talking about this for a year straight. Everyone's like, so when's more coming? Like, we're ready.
There's so much room for development and so much room for growth and just just, yeah. Yeah, you did such a great job with your character. I just loved it. So.
Thank you very much. So, very kind words, my friend.
Thank you.
Thank you. If you haven't seen it, check it out, you guys. It's under an hour. My dear friend Adam is going to show a clip after I'm done here, and you guys can get a little sample of it. You can literally, all the episodes are like 5 to 7 minutes long, and you can watch all of them in like 45 minutes.
Hello.
Have you seen it?
Hi.
Hi, Piper.
Hi, Piper. Love that name.
Thank you. I was wondering, considering how many times Castiel has sacrificed all the angels in heaven to save the Winchesters, what do you think Gadriel's opinion of Castiel is?
Well, I think he's probably suspect of him in the beginning when we meet Gadriel. He was probably finding out everything that's happening from Metatron, and Metatron, of course, making him believe that Castiel is the enemy and that he is to be destroyed. But I think very quickly after Metatron, you know, forces or asks of Gadriel to kill many other angels, even his best friends, it gets to a point where he realizes he can't trust this man anymore, and that what he's doing is going too far, and he probably doesn't believe much of what anything that Metatron says anymore, and he's probably, I mean, it's obvious, as you see in the arc of the story, when near the end, he actually goes to Castiel and says, you know, listen, this is about honor. I think we're all missing the point of what it is to be an angel. And he very clearly says it in his final speech before he takes his own life. And I think Castiel even forgets what it's like, what their mission truly is as angels on Earth, to put the humans first, to protect them.
Hi, I'm Jenny.
Hi, Jenny.
I saw you speak last year at HousCon, and hearing you speak today, I'm really struck by how grounded and down to earth you seem. You seem very zen.
Thank you very much.
And you've been in some of my favorite series, you know, Dollhouse, PSG, Bomb Girls, and just wondering how you're able to stay so grounded in an industry that can be focused on the superficial.
Well, that's a very, very good question. You know, it's challenging. Life is challenging. Regardless of what walk of life, you know, we come from, everyone has challenges. You know, there might be a perception that us in this industry, and you obviously don't have that perception, you're very, you know, observant and know that it's very, very difficult, and it is superficial. For me, being the humble little northern Canadian boy that I am, every time I go back to Hollywood, and it's been my home off and on for, you know, a partial home for me for many years, it's always challenging for me arriving back in that city then. Energetically, it's a different place. There's a real obsession with youth, and as you said, superficiality. There's a darkness to that city that's always a challenge for me when I first get there. And, you know, I make the transition. It's old and I've been there. There's a lot of fantastic things about it. There's a lot of fantastic things about this industry. But it is difficult. I am human. I'm like everybody else. I have challenges all the time. I get depressed. I struggle with, you know, keeping my chin up in this business because it can be very difficult at times. But, you know, that's life. That's unfortunately the journey that we're all on in this plane. It's, you know, everything can't always be perfect all the time. That's not the experience we're supposed to have. But there's things you can do to make it easier. You know, meditation is one of those things that helps me a lot. Exercise, eating right, doing things that make me happy. This is one of them. Having fun. You know, for years, when I was doing Muay Thai, I was trying to be a professional actor on the side, and I have a problem with being a little bit of a perfectionist. And I'd be so hard on myself sometimes because I couldn't, to do it at a high level, you have to be training at least 4 days a week, and for hours, at least 4 days a week. And it was very difficult for me to do when I was doing 14-hour days on set. And it'd be really difficult with myself because I couldn't get a technique, or more than anything, it was usually for me just the conditioning. I didn't have the wind to be able to fight at the level that I knew I could physically, but I just hadn't been doing the training. And I'd be so hard on myself, and I'd get so frustrated. And my coach finally stopped me once, and he was like, Tahmoh, like, you gotta have fun, man. Just have fun. Stop being so hard on yourself. Have fun. It's such a simple thing that we so easily forget, you know. And obviously, work isn't fun sometimes, you know. You know, things that we have to do in everyday life that we don't enjoy. But you gotta find the fun in stuff. You really do. It's a mantra and a thing that I try and remind myself when I'm getting really cranky or frustrated, or I'm looking for the negative and I'm spiraling into a negative space. You know, just have fun. We're only here for a short amount of time this time around. And there's certain things you can incorporate in your life, you know, by being positive and trying to make the positive choices, eating well and taking care of yourself, meditating and having fun.
Great words to live by.
Thank you. Boys are back. Hold on, you can take one. Somebody else waiting. Do we cut anybody off? Did we ruin it? Did we just ruin the party?
Yeah.
So anyway. Gosh darn it.
He just gave a great answer, though. It was a great, it's actually a good one to go out on, I would think.
It was great. If only I knew the question, I would have enjoyed the answer.
I know you never.
You guys have been fantastic. Thank you so much.